Welcome to NPTEL, the National Program on Technology Enhanced Learning, being brought to you by the Indian Institutes of Technology and the Indian Institute of Science. The course that we are offering to you is entitled English Language and Literature, and I heartily welcome you to these 40 lectures that are being shared by me with my colleague at IIT Guwahati, Professor Krishna Barua. We are at the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences. This lecture is introductory in nature, and it's really more like a preview of things that are going to come, things that are going to be discussed in the following lectures. When we say English language and literature, particularly today, it is not without its attendant problems. The study of English as a discipline has had a very long history, and as we shall see in one of our lectures entitled English in India, you would be surprised, that is if you do not know it already, that the study of English literature as a discipline in colleges and universities did not begin in the mother country, England, but in India. So, the study of English language and literature, okay, as a discipline is not one of merely, you know, learning, okay, for instance, the history of English literature or the history of English language or the usage of English language or the, you know, learning English for special purposes, okay. It is fraught with many political concerns, much of which has been already the subject of debate. So, really, how do we go about designing a course? How do we go about designing its contents? It was rather difficult, but we have more or less tried to accommodate, okay, many or at least some of the concerns that I had talked about just a while ago when doing English language and literature as a discipline is concerned. Okay. So, what I will do now is unpack the contents of our course so as to enable you to have a glimpse of what is included here. Now, let me also say at the outset that this course is aimed at students at, you know, at the beginning level, right? The course was designed under the National Program on Technology Enhanced Learning, whose main target, okay, comprises the students in engineering colleges, in IITs in the country. So, with that in view, many of, you know, we want wish to tell you that many of you may find this a little too elementary, okay. Nevertheless, let me tell you what we wish to bring to you, and in our course content we had mentioned this as our course preamble, so to speak, that this course seeks to impart in both a compact and comprehensive manner the necessary, okay, the necessary knowledge in English language and literature that an undergraduate student should possess, or at least parts of which a student, such a student, is expected to possess. Further, the course aims to help students understand English language and literature using a multifaceted methodology that includes the historical, the linguistic, the literary, and the critical dimensions. Okay. So, what we find here in our, you know, course justification or preamble is this: A, that it is aim to be both compact and comprehensive. Okay, it is aimed at the undergraduate student. Okay, who is expected to know a bit about some of the aspects of English language and literature, and also that the methodology used here is one that touches upon the historical, the linguistic, the literary, including, which you will find in our last module, including the critical dimensions. Okay. So, now let us quickly run through the topics that we have in our course. We begin with the introduction, which is today's lecture. Okay, introduction, as I had said, will introduce you to the various modules and give you glimpses of not all, it is not possible to do all a glimpse of all of the lectures, but at least we will give you an idea of what to expect. So, the first lecture is introductory in nature. The second lecture is the scope of English studies. The English language is our next lecture, followed by the alchemy of English, international English, the globalization of English, world Englishes, and the rise of cultural studies. Now, this entire module 1 would be taken up by me, the lectures here would be delivered by me, and the next also, which is the module which is entitled the history of the English language. So, this introductory module and the lectures therein would be delivered by me, followed by the next module, which is on exclusively on the history of the English language. The lectures here will also be delivered by me. We all have an introductory lecture, introduction to the English language, followed by various periods of or ages in the history of the English language, beginning with Old English, followed by Middle English, Early Modern English, Modern English, and you also have included a lecture entitled English in India from more or less a historical perspective. Okay, so the first, as you know, the first module will discuss certain aspects of English language and literature, taking where we would like to draw attention to some of the problematics of the scope of English language and literature, trying to show you how the study and teaching of English language and literature has changed over time, what are the different nuances that have come in. For instance, the word English studies is one that is preferred by many today instead of the more traditional English language and literature. Okay. The second module, as you know, is devoted exclusively to the study of the English language in a historical sense. Okay. Module 3 is a module that is taken care of by my colleague, as I said, Professor Krishna Borra. This module is devoted to the different ages or different periods in English literary history. Okay. Just a while ago, we saw that module 2 is on English, the history of the English language. This third module will talk about literature. Okay, from the point of view of the different ages that are demarcated, okay, and how literature changes over the ages, right. So, we have the age of Chaucer as our first lecture here, followed by the age of Shakespeare. These are really well known, well demarcated, you could say established, almost canonical ways of looking at different periods in English literary history. So, the age of Chaucer, the age of Shakespeare, then we have the third lecture entitled Milton and his times, followed by the Augustans, the Romantics, the Victorians, modern literature, and as in the second module, we have also devoted one lecture to Indian literature in English. So, this module will be taken care of by Professor Krishna Borra. So, also the next module. Now, the next module is devoted to the different genres of English literature. Not that these are exclusive to English literature, but these are the genres in the texts in the various genres that we find here are taken up, the nature of each genre, for instance the novel, okay, and examples therein, then poetry, drama, essay, short story, biography and autobiography. Okay, so this would be taken up, taught by Professor Krishna Bora. Finally, we come, as I had said earlier, that we are going to devote, and I think this is a module where we have the most number of lectures. Okay, this module is devoted entirely to literary criticism, and we hope this will be useful not to simply our target audience, but also to as a refresher, so to speak, okay, of what we had learnt earlier, to students in the MA level and the PhD level as well. Okay, so there are a number of critical theories, critical schools that we have to offer here, and this module, which is the last module, is being shared by Professor Krishna Bora and me. So the first school that we look at is classical criticism, okay, followed by liberal humanism, Marxism, feminism, reader response criticism, new historicism, eco-criticism, structuralism, post-structuralism, post-colonialism and finally cognitivism, which is supposed to be the new paradigm, so to speak, of literary criticism. Okay? So, you have by now a brief idea of what is at offer here, right? So, what I am going to do now is I am going to tell you how we are going to go about teaching this course, this online course. This is a matter of pedagogy really, and what is pedagogy? Pedagogy is defined as the art and the science of teaching. Okay? Right? So, in pedagogy, when we declare our pedagogy, we are also trying to tell you how we are going to go about. Okay? So, as I can only speak for myself here, what I have done here is like we do in our classroom, for instance. Okay? So, if I am talking about say feminist literary criticism, or I am say talking about English, the scope of English studies, I am going to bring to you several several articulations, okay, made by well-known scholars and critics. This is not a research paper that I am presenting to you or a seminar paper. Okay, what I am doing here is I'm getting to you as far as possible some of the best articulations and formulations in every lecture. Okay, in the topic, on the topic in every lecture that has been there in the literature. Do you follow? Okay, so from time to time I shall be giving you quotations that you may use, I shall be gleaning points from extracts, okay, so as to try and enrich the discussion that we are that we have when we are talking about these. Okay, so from time to time I shall also maybe declare the key text, the source text, okay, and whenever I shall be quoting from somebody, I shall mention that this is a quotation from a particular scholar. Fine. So let's look at what we are going to discuss in the next few lectures. Okay. Now, as I said, English language and literature is sought by many, to be supplanted with this phrase, English studies, right? So as to maybe in a bid to remove the idea that English language and literature is something that is only written in the mother country or written by written in what we call the Anglo-American scenario. Okay? So, the scope of English studies is one way of looking at English language and literature, which is also one way of really another way of defining what we are going to do in this course. So, what does the scope of English studies tell us? And for this we have a whole lecture, okay, which I think is the next lecture in this module. So, the scope of English studies includes literatures that are written in English, okay, not just literature that comes from England. So, literatures that are written in English, and also study of English linguistics, language matters, okay, and English social linguistics. So, these are the three broad areas that are considered under English language and literature, some of which we are bringing to you. Then it is not that only these are, you know, these are the key areas, but there are other things that have today or that today find place in the study of English, and these are, you know, for instance, journalism or journalese, the study of journalistic language, for instance, is another thing, another aspect of the study of English language and literature, particularly from popular culture, that has come to be incorporated. Okay, so this is just to show you the scope, how far one can go. We are not going to talk about journalese or journalistic writing here, but in a bit to just throw open, okay, the contours of this. We are mentioning these here. So, journalism, the philosophy of language, okay, literary theory and criticism, which you are of course taking up, creative writing is also another very important aspect of English language and literature departments, okay, and electronic texts and publishing, hypertext, okay, the digital humanities, right. These are the newer areas that are being incorporated in the larger rubric of English language and literature or English studies, as I have mentioned. Then film and media and communication, right. So, communication could mean better communication. I think in NPTEL, under the aegis of NPTEL, you have lectures on I think communication skills and better English or better communication. Okay. So, you can get an idea of how broad this is, and also at the same time you may excuse us for not being able to, within the framework of 40 lectures, why we are not able to bring you everything. Okay. Then also there is this important, very important aspect, very though functional, though pragmatic, yet very important aspect of the question of proficiency in English language, which is also not being taken up here, because there are other courses in NPTEL that do that, and this is also to do with the use of English in, you know, is for special purposes, okay, for business purposes, for world policy purposes, for instance, for scientific writing, for instance, and also English, the use of English as a second language, not just from the question of its usage, but also from the point of view of the politics inherent in the study of English as a second language. Fine. Rob Pope, in an essay, has described this discipline as something which has, as he says, a capacious subject matter. It is very accommodating. Okay, it is capacious. There are, as we've seen just a while ago, there are many, and I think I'm sure in years to come there'll be many topics which we couldn't even think of today that would come under the bigger rubric or the larger rubric of English language and literature. So, there are also questions of pedagogy. How does one teach a poem in class? Okay, when you teach a poem written by an Indian in English, and when you teach a poem written by Shelley, for instance, are there differences there? Okay, so the pedagogical aspect is also another important teaching and research aspect of English language and literature, and most importantly here, English language and literature, English studies has become increasingly interdisciplinary. Okay, being informed by political theories, from political economy, from psychology, from sociology. Okay, so this is really not one discipline; it is many disciplines really inhering. Okay, in supposedly one discipline called English language and literature. Next, we also have to keep in mind the point called discourse. Okay, discourse is a very loaded term, particularly in literary theory and cultural studies. I'm not going to go into that, but it is also important when we study English language and literature, or for that matter, any language and literature. Okay, it is very important that you understand that these are discourses. Discourses, very plainly put, are ways of speaking, okay? There are ways of speaking within a certain framework where there is a terminology, an established terminology, and where you are supposed to talk in a certain way, okay? So, these then texts become objects for us, they are objects of discourse, okay? They are discursive formations or objects. They are also, if you look at this slide, structured systems, okay? That could be studied systematically, and they are in the commonsensical or everyday sense of the term, they are texts, but these texts are also ideological system in the sense that they are saturated with the ideology of an age, the ideology of a writer, and eventually the ideology of the reader. Okay? So, these are some of the things that you need to keep in mind, that when we look at a text, it is not that a text is just there and that we are, you know, the teacher has all the knowledge and is going to impart the knowledge on your text. Keep in mind that texts are discursive formations, they are objects and they are saturated with ideology. This discourse, okay, that is including all the texts that we are referring to, all the texts that you may study within this subject, also, you know, has to be looked at from the point of view of power. Okay, this is something that we will discuss later on in, I think, in our lecture on cultural rise of cultural studies in English literature. But discourse creates power. Okay, the power of a text, okay, the power of a text to form our values, the power of a text to, you know, to give us meaning, to give us significance. Okay, it's said here, truth, to create truth, to influence our practices, to create meaning, and finally to create our moral sense or you know, our ethics. Okay, so remember, texts are not today considered innocuous objects. Okay, or you know, texts are ideological systems which have enormous power. Okay, and when we do English in India, for instance, that's something that is going to come about among other lectures. Fine. Then, identity, texts give us identity and contribute to our subjectivity, right? This is also going to be taken up eventually. This is just to give you an idea of, you know, how we are to be alert when we read texts, how we are to be alert when we devise syllabi, for instance. Okay? So, texts give us our identity, contribute at least to identity creation and subjectivity. These are also aspects that are going to be taken up in some of our lectures. Then, we also need to consider, okay, at least from a cultural studies point of view, right, that texts are not separate, literary texts are not separate, or even the study of literary history, you know, is not separate from issues of class, ethnicity, caste, race, gender, and our sexual orientation. Okay? These texts touch upon, it's not that they just touch upon, they are also informed, okay, by these key terms in the study of literature and culture, that is class, gender, ethnicity, race, and sexuality. Fine. Now, the we'll move on to another lecture which you know, will feature in this module, and this is the whole concept. You know, just a while ago we were talking about the cultural studies aspect of doing English language and literature. Now, we are talking about the whole aspect of the whole question of world Englishes. Okay? Now, look at the word Englishes. We no longer talk about English in the singular. Okay? Increasingly, the variation in the use of English, not only in its spoken manifestations, but also in the literary text, okay, is so varied, right? English is found in so many parts of the world, and the variation is so much that, for instance, if you look at this slide here, Braj Kachru, one of the most well-known figures in the study of world English, calls it world Englishes, okay, in the plural. Approaches in his essay World Englishes, approaches issues and resources. He talks about the spread. This is from a lecture in this module that I have taken up here, just to give you an idea. Spread and stratification of English, the characteristics of the stratification of English, its interactional context, the implications of the spread of English, and the descriptive and prescriptive concerns. Okay, that so it's not a question of, you know, of us looking at just or just admitting or recognizing the fact that there are different Englishes in the world. Okay, but the questions that in here and are going to be discussed in one of the lectures here are questions of stratification of English. Okay, question of the context of how people interact and the different scenarios in different parts of the world where English is different from one another, and the what are the implications, social, political, economic, of the spread of English in such a manner, and what are the prescriptive concerns. Okay, what are the prescribed ways, do we adhere to or should we adhere to prescribed ways of speaking when we are not speaking in the mother country or when we are not from so called mother country, and how does English resist, so to speak, how does a different variety of English, okay, resist the prescriptive concerns and ideologies of the so called English proper. Fine, so this is also one of the things that is you know, it's going to come about in our discussion. Therefore, when you talk about English in its many variations, okay, we also realize that there are multiple norms of style, right. So, just a while ago we were talking about the prescriptive versions of English. Today we do not talk about that. Within the study of English language and literature, for instance, if you start reading a text like say Arundhati Roy's The God of Small Things, okay, you see the willing breaking of rules, the willing breaking of norms of so called prescriptive English. Okay, so, the question is also about how do creative writers, for instance, okay, play with the language, change the English language in order to make it more creative, in order to almost you could even say sometimes provoke us into understanding that English may be used in different ways. Okay, so there are, as I said, multiple norms of style, questions of multiple norms of style inherent here. There are altered context, situational situations for acculturation, for instance. There are multiple codes, okay, in which English is written. There is also formal stylistic experimentation in today in the writing and even reading of English, as a result of which we have new norms. Okay, so we have these exciting new norms that are cultural, that are aesthetic, and that are semiotic or symbolic. And this, to my mind, is something that we need to celebrate. There is something that we need to address. Okay, in any course today that is floated on English language and literature. So, these are the also some of the points that I shall be discussing in the following lectures. So, then we have a lecture on international English. Okay. Now, why do we need a lecture on international English when we, for instance, have a lecture or separately on world Englishes? Now, the important difference here is that while, as you see in this slide, while English world Englishes as a sub-discipline focuses on the variety, as I said, the variants of English all over the world in different countries, international English does the opposite. International English tries to or attempts to figure out the ways in which we can have you know, we can have a standard, you know, it's the whole idea of the standardized English, okay, which seeks to have what we call here a non-localized English, an international English that is. So, if English has become so different, do we need, particularly for instance, for the scientific community, for the research community, okay. So, there on the one hand, whereas we have professors like Braj Kachru talking about world Englishes, on the other hand, we also have attempts which may not have been very successful, okay, because there is a lot of resistance, attempts at internationalizing English or at devising an international norm, okay, with common vocabulary, for instance, a set pronunciation, for instance, okay, terminology, for instance, for that. So, there is also a lecture separately devoted to international English. This slide I will skip because this will be talked about in that particular lecture. Okay. Then, when we come to English, the next module, that is English language and literature, this will begin by by introducing the language to you. For instance, it will begin by telling you that English is a West Germanic language, okay, belonging to the Indo-European family of languages, right? And it will tell you over several lectures how English changed, right? How English changed in terms of vocabulary, in terms of its many attempts at standardization, its many locales, okay? It will also talk about some of the socio-economic political issues, also technology, for instance, the printing press, the coming of the printing press, and how the English language has changed, you know, over the different periods of the history of English language, for instance, Old English right down to Modern English, for instance. So, this is what is going to be discussed. We should know that more or less English is the official language in 51 countries. And it is a substantial it has substantial native English speakers in 104. It is the third most spoken language, okay, in the world, and more than 600 million people are supposed to have English as a second or a third language, right? Now, I don't want to sound too celebratory, but because this is a course on English language and literature, we need to see where the language stands, okay, as far as its usage is concerned, as far as the population that uses it is concerned, okay. So this proliferation of English, if you go back to its roots, we will see in the lectures that English came about with the marauding tribes, okay, called the Angles, Saxons and Jutes, go back to history. And in fact, the word English or England can be traced back to the name given by the Angles as Anglerland, okay, from which eventually we have England, right. So, the history can be traced back to the tribes called the Angles, Saxons and Jutes that took over England. Then we will find that in the Middle English period, which was a period of great change, we find the very important French or the Norman French conquest and the conditions that followed, and also certain tendencies of Old English, which also manifested themselves, and the changes that affected the grammar and vocabulary of the English language. Then we look at an important attempt at standardizing English, and which was the rise of standard English by the end of the 14th century, right? And this is to do with a particular region that we will read about, we'll talk about in our lectures, okay, and how it came about, because not because of just one reason, but because of because of a trade, for instance, because of commerce, for instance, because of a certain locale, a certain dialect that came to rise up as the standard form of English after the 14th century. So, here in following that, in the early modern period, we will find that there are further changes, okay. For instance, in the development of modern English, we find in the history of the development of modern English, we find how important the printing press was, right, and the changes that came about because of the printing press, and when people began to read a particular version of English, okay, how it led to how it was the first time perhaps when there was this prescriptive, because everyone would read that a particular word in a particular spelling, even though there may have been variants in the various dialects, but it so came about that because of the availability of the same copy, so to speak, okay, the population began to slowly adjust itself to specific norms of spelling, to specific norms of grammar, okay. Today, a couple of decades ago, it was the BBC really, which has taken that place in the modern world, okay, and when you call the BBC English, as many consider it to be the standard form of English, okay. So, printing press, then the spread of popular education, the growth of social consciousness, increased communication and means of social communication, these are very important aspects. And as I said, we are not going to give you simply a list of how the language changed over the different periods. We are also going to talk to you about the socio-economic conditions and the technology, the contributions from technology that lead, you know, that are sort of behind the scenes in the change of the English language, for instance, for that matter any language, okay, from time to time. Fine. Then in the next module, which is devoted to genres, module 4, I think, which is devoted to genres, we'll have Professor Krishna Bora talking to you about the various genres or kinds of or the forms of literature, okay. For instance, she'll talk to you about the novel, its history, and it's going in the same way about poetry, drama, autobiography, short story, essay, and biography, okay. She's going to talk to you about the specific characteristics of each form and how each form developed, okay, owing to certain reasons. She is also going to bring to you a certain text which are going to be explicated in a bit to show you their characteristic form. Okay. So, basically these are the forms: the novel, the essay, the short story, biography, autobiography, poetry and drama that are going to be taught in in one of the modules. Next, an important thing which we thought we should add was to study at least one or two lectures devoted to the question of English in India. Okay, so there are two lectures that are devoted to at a very elementary level, a very introductory level of English in India, one from the point of view of the language and one exclusively devoted to Indian literature in English, or what we call IWE, or Indian writing in English. Okay. So, for instance, in my lecture in English in India, for instance, you will find how politically there was, with the introduction of English language and English literature studies, behind this was there were several changes in policy, and each change in policy told us what the ideology was that was set, that was aimed at. For instance, from 1830 to 1850, we find that texts that talked about or described Christian imagery, okay, talked about English ideals and standards, were the texts that were sought to be brought to the students in India. Okay. After 1850, there is a change. We find that there was a secular stance. So, the aim was not Christian imagery or Western ideals and standards, but a more secular stance. The target or the aim for which was to encourage the Indians to contribute towards the British commercial and administrative goals. So, let us then move on to the final module and what we have to offer there. One of the established ways of looking at literary texts, okay, one of the most systematic ways, okay, of theorizing has been the Marxist way of looking at English at literary texts, okay, English or otherwise. And there we shall see how the literary text is part of what Marx calls the superstructure. Okay, Marx had this two-tier system of the base and the superstructure, the base comprising the relations of production and the forces of production. If you are interested to know more about this, I may guide you to two of my lectures in another online course under NPTEL, which is cultural studies, where I have two lectures in two parts, a lecture in two parts entitled Marxism Part 1 and Part 2. If you want to know more about Marxism, I could guide you to that. But here we are going to look at the literary text in its relation to the economic base and in its relation as a part of the superstructure. Okay. For instance, we have a quotation in the in the lecture entitled the Marxist critic Georgi Plekhanov, and this will give you an idea of what we are going to discuss there. The social mentality of an age is conditioned by that age's social relations. So, the social consciousness of an age, okay, depends on the social relations that are there, the social relations of production, a production of material goods, in a sense, right? And then he goes on to say, this is nowhere quite as evident as in the history of art and literature. So, the history of art and literature will, in a complex and sophisticated way, give you an idea of the social mentality or social consciousness of that age. And there are many critics who have given us different ways of looking at literary, as a literary text from a Marxist point of view. Okay, so since literary theory and criticism is an important part of this course, there are many ways in which you will see a literary text can be or could be studied. For instance, if you look at the method of Marxist criticism in that lecture, you will find that we ask questions like, for instance, what ideology, okay, or worldview does a text or a literary movement seek to enforce, right? In what ways does, for instance, a text reveal and invite us to attest or to condemn that ideology? Again, another question may be raised, how far is the text ideologically straightforward, or is it ideologically conflicted? Is it a propagandist text in the main? Then how are the socio-economic conditions, that is the base we talked about a while ago, reflected in the text, and do these reveal the specifics of class struggle? So, these are some of the questions that may come, and then we've talked about Hamlet here, which we're not going to unpack here. There are each and every text of literature could be very successfully systematically analyzed from a Marxist perspective, right? So, also when we talk about feminist criticism and we find how a patriarchy is one of the most important concepts in feminism, and how patriarchy informs, informs certain literary texts, and how we can look at them when we look at the ideologies that a text upholds, and we can look at a text from the gendered power structures that are there, and studying the material lives not only of women but of men and of the family, and the representations particularly of women that are there in the literary text. This is also something that is going to come about in our discussion. For instance, Pramod Nair talks about how feminist criticism looks at the representation of women in art. Now, not just only in for instance, the novel, okay, it is also in depictions, in pictorial depictions, in images, okay, in popular culture, okay, in films, in television, for instance, how feminist criticism looks at how women are represented, okay, are shown in this. Then the material conditions of the lives of women that are depicted in these texts. These are some of the concerns of feminist criticism. Then we are going to look at the post-structuralist school. We are going to look at deconstruction, okay, and there is also a lecture on post-colonialism. Herein we are going to talk about the important concepts of how the text is imbued with ideology, with difference, how meaning is generated, okay, how identity is generated, and how to critique a text from, say, a post-colonial or a deconstructive perspective. So, the post here means there are certain changes and departures, for instance, departures from a colonialist, departures from a modernist, and departures from structuralist. Okay? So, these are just some of, I cannot talk about all of these, some of the things that we are bringing to you through our lectures. Structuralism as a literary tool is again an important event in the history of English literary criticism, and through Ferdinand de Saussure's idea of how the sign is split, some of you may already know this, how the sign is split into the signifier and signified, how meaning emanates, these are some of the things that are going to be discussed, and how a literary text really is a structured system. Okay, is a structured system that can be analyzed in a systematic scientific way following the different units and rules that make up the literary text. Okay, the binary opposites we find there in matters of characterization, of theme, of morality, for instance. These are some of the things that tools we can use when we try and decode the literary text. Okay. Then finally, we are going to look at relatively new, if I may use the word, which is a new way of looking at the literary text, which came about really in a big way. It was not that it was not there before, came about in a big way, following what we call the decade of the brain, the 1990s, okay, and you know, it is a decade which is termed the decade of the brain. The many discoveries, you know, of the brain, particularly following non-invasive technologies like fMRI or PET scans, for instance, okay, and how we can, you know, enrich literary criticism by using some of the formulations and findings from, okay, to look at the literary text as a product of a cognitive mind, product of a mind that perceives. Okay, a product of a you know, by cognition we mean several things, for instance, include several things like perception, attention, memory, etcetera. Okay, so these are looked at not from a clinical point of view, but how the present discourse, okay, can on the literary text can be enriched. For instance, the literary texts here are seen as, if you look at the slide, are seen as cognitive artifacts which are produced by cognitive beings. Okay, so certain algorithms and deep structures, for instance, like metaphor, okay, analogy, definition, categorization, combination and blending, are the procedures that underlie literary text. So these are some of the new terms that we find, okay, in the sense, not new terms but new approaches from a cognitive point of view. Okay, for instance, conceptual blending is one that had a way of looking at a text that had great you know, great appeal, I think, even back from the 1970s, right. So, or finally, the question, are we creative only in limited ways, right. So, these are some of the issues that are going to be discussed in the last lecture of this course. So, this is really quite a lot that I have talked about here, and you by now must be wondering, you know, where we are going. As I said in the beginning, this course is both compact and comprehensive. We have divided these into modules, okay, we have tried to be you know, tried to adhere to both the traditionalist way of doing English language and literature in universities, and also, okay, try to keep you up to date, for instance, by looking at the cognitive revolution in literary studies, for instance, looking at issues of world Englishes, of the globalization of English. Okay, so it is, I admit, a mixed course, you know, it is quite a medley here, but really we have tried to show you that there are various things, and also pointing to some of the things that may come in the future, the various things that you can accommodate in the study of English language and literature. So, I will see you in the next lecture, which is more really a detailed lecture on the scope of English studies. Thank you.